So, let's get our previously on, shall we?
What's going on, guys? Welcome to the show. As always, I got Dude and Sheik with me. Margot's internet's out. He'll be back with us next week.
He's going to have some better internet finally,
yeah,
they lied to him. He thought he had got the Bell 5 last time, and it wasn't the case. So
that's kind of messed
up. We'll see him next week.
And at least he's going to get a nice credit out of it, I hope so.
Yeah, hopefully.
We'll have him back with us next week. So how are you guys doing this week?
Doing good, man. Doing good. Went to a little show last Saturday. I was on my way to celebrate my father's birthday. That's why I wasn't able to join you guys with Royally Fuck. And unfortunately, I think we ended up having to cancel, eh?
Yeah, it happened. You know.
Sometimes, you know, play first. But I also got stopped by a little show. It's always nice to go to those local shows, see people, you know, you've met over the years, make new friends, talk to different people, and of course buy books. So I bought a couple books. I've posted two of them so far on my Instagram. So, that's what I've been up to.
Nice. Sheik, how about you? How are you doing?
Good. Yeah, it's always good. It's been a great year for comics.
So far.
Catching up with everything. Yeah. And there's still so many books coming out. So it's a good time.
All right. Well, before we jump into it, let's say hello to the chat. I see, as always, we got Mr. Baker in here at 12:17 p.m. And, of course, need a hero himself. Paul,
hello. How are you
this evening? I see we got Phil in here. Phil, what's going on?
It's these guys. What's going on, Phil?
And I believe, there we go. I saw Callie popping in here. Callie, what's up?
Hey.
All right. Well, we got a good one for tonight. As always, you know, we got the usual stuff. So we're going to go ahead and jump right into it. We'll start off with the new comic book day and that day.
Everybody say hello to the bad guy.
As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster.
I believe whatever doesn't kill you simply makes you murder.
Stranger. It means that I'm not the Samaritan. That I'm not the priest. Or the Levite. That I am the ill intent.
That's why I'm the kingpin.
What? Say what again? Say what again? I dare you. I double dare you, motherfucker. Say what one more goddamn time.
You need people like me so you can point your fucking fingers and say that's the bad guy. So say
goodnight
to the bad guy.
Oh, I guess we're never going to get that PG rating.
No, never, man. Never. Yeah, I had a good time. That was good. Yeah. I had to fight hard not to turn my camera on for that one.
Right. Yeah. All right. Well, first up this week, we've got some more of the Ultimate Universe. Of course, we got Ultimate Spider-Man number 3 from Marvel Comics. This is by Jonathan Hickman and Marco Cicchetto. What fucked the spacing all up on that slide? Good job. So this is going to be the first appearance of Ultimate Daredevil, I believe. He's going to be showing up in this one. So, you know. Or not, I'm not. I'm sorry, not Daredevil. Fucking Ultimate Bullseye, whatever the fuck is
that. Yeah. I was like, wait, what?
I'm sure Ultimate Daredevil's not far behind, right? Probably. Yeah. Maybe. Who knows? Maybe. We'll see. But this is the Elizabeth Torque variant. You know, It was just, I don't know. Not bad cover. I was kind of torn between it and the A cover, I guess. So I was just like, oh, I'll go with this one. Fuck it.
It's not bad.
You guys,
I was so confused backstage. I had sworn this had already come out. Phaser reminded me, no, it hadn't. Maybe it's just all these Ultimate titles coming out. But I was like, damn, okay. I'm looking forward to reading it. It's been good so far.
It has been pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Nice cover. Yeah. I mean,
are you reading it at all?
Yeah. On the pull list. It's a good book. And yeah, I'll check it out.
What do you think about it versus the rest of the Ultimate Universe that we've got so far?
I think all of the Ultimate books are good. I just don't care for Black Panther, to be honest. Like, I'm not a big Black Panther fan. And even though I thought the book was good, I'll check out issue 3, but I don't know if I'll stay on it. Just again, like, I'm not a big fan. But X-Men I really enjoyed, and I'll definitely be keeping up with that. And then same thing with Spider-Man.
Yeah, Black Panther was kind of a choice. I mean, I guess it makes sense because, you know, obviously the character's popular right now with the MCU and everything like that. But yeah, I mean, the comics have never really been big sellers, so no. I don't know. Whatever. I think probably Spider-Man is my favorite so far of the three. But we'll see how it holds up. Plus, we got Ultimates coming too. Right, next up we've got this one was a little surprising to me because you know, like Sheik, you've mentioned it numerous times. This is actually the 300th issue for Miles, and it's basically getting no like fanfare or anything. Like, they're not really doing anything special for it. You're just giving it a Garson cover, a few others.
It's not even an oversight, is it?
It's weird that Nightwing and Miles like both have 300 issues, like about to hit 300. And I think it shows you like how much Marvel like pumps certain characters. Like, it's kind of crazy when you think about how long like one character has been around versus the other. Like,
yeah, right.
Yeah, I guess one's been in like a lot of team books. Like, if you count all the Titans appearances and stuff, it would add up to a lot more. Yeah. So in that sense, it's not crazy. But I do love this. And I did pick up this cover, and I got cover A. And that's saying something because this is a $9 book.
Cover A as well, the insignia.
No, just cover A. Like, the Vicentini. Like, it's like all the other covers, just like Miles doing some shit with a character. I've always had Miles on the pull list. Like, I can't remember last time I haven't had Miles on the pull list. Maybe like before Saladin Ahmed's run on the Miles, like Miles Morales Spider-Man 1. I think that's. I've had Miles on my pull list since then, so that was like a 38 issue run, and this one's up to 18. So yeah, I do love Miles. Even like when I dropped ASM, I still kept Miles because I enjoyed him more. And this cover is awesome. I do love this kind of cover. They do a lot for the Marvel characters when they have these kinds of milestones, which I appreciate. I got the one for Immortal Hulk. I got the can't remember who the most recent character was before this. They got one, but I even got the one for Thor a while back. So I definitely had to get this one. And then even not Garson, but Jamal Campbell is doing like a separate, a similar kind of theme with the like this kind of collage cover for Nightwing 300. So, yeah, I love these collage covers.
Ooh, that's a good question. I think it's gonna be Twilight, to be honest. I mean,
yeah, Ultimates is just you have the problem with Ultimates is that you're gonna compare it to. Like, yeah, Twilight is compared to Kingdom Come. Yeah, but Ultimate's going to get compared to the first one, which was back then, like, groundbreaking. And it's like, it's kind of like trying to do Planetary again. It's like, yeah, you could still get a lot of hype, but it's like the first time it was completely new. It was different. It came at an appropriate time. So I feel like Ultimates will be good, but Twilight, it just kind of came out of nowhere. And it's like, you have a Cunha artwork. I feel like that's hard to compete with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I guess it's as canon as an alternate universe gets with Marvel or DC these days. So who knows? I mean, I guess if there's a character that stands out from it and really gets popular, I'm sure they'll fucking find a way to bring him over into the regular Marvel universe. Why not?
Yeah.
So, I think were they counting his original run in like Ultimate Spider-Man with the 300 on these?
I think so, but I'm not entirely sure.
There couldn't have been 300 fucking issues of Miles that have come out yet, have there? I don't think so. It has to count.
That's what I was thinking. That's what I was like kind of saying is like, that's kind of crazy. Cause I don't think there's been 300. They might be counting like the ultimate run, but at the same time, I'm not entirely sure what they're counting. Cause Marvel just makes shit up sometimes with these.
Right. And then how deep would you go into that fucking ultimate run if you are counting it? Because I mean, are they counting the whole run or are they just counting where Miles shows up? And then,
I recently did the same thing because there's certain characters I know just from my chronological, like, internal clock that, like, their time is coming up for some sort of milestone. So, Dick, I knew, like, Dick Grayson, I knew way before it was coming up. I knew it was coming up. That's why I think I tweeted, like, a year or two ago at DC saying, like, I hope you guys have something planned because it's going to be 44th anniversary in a couple of years, you know, where it'll be, like, 44 years he's been Robin, 44 years he's been Nightmare, which is insane. But, Green Arrow, I did this thing the other day where I looked up his numbers because I've read every issue of Green Arrow individually, and I'm reading them again, some of them for the most part. And I looked this up, and my basic rule was anything that's titled Green Arrow, I counted. So if it's like a Green Arrow solo title, I counted it. And it had to be, of course, a mini or an ongoing or something.
Right.
And then like there's caveats of like there's a point of time where there was no Green Arrow being published, but there's Green Arrow and Black Canary, which is effectively the Green Arrow book. So I counted all of those, and Green Arrow is up, like the next issue of Green Arrow is 300, and DC doesn't even know it. Like they're releasing it without even knowing it. Like I don't think they know it's
issue. Maybe they're just not counting the Black Canary books.
But you have to, because like that's the only Green Arrow book that was like that was published then. So I feel like you have to count it because he was in the book like the whole time,
right?
And it ran for like 30 something issues. So it's like,
As it turns out, legacy numbering is just fucking weird, and it's seems like it's another way to sell comics.
I miss the days of just like don't renumber. Like, just don't renumber. Like, there's no point to renumbering. Like, Marvel just does it to get a tiny boost in sales because they charge higher for number ones. And there is, of course, people who generally just buy more number ones. But I'm telling you, like, it's such a short term. Like, it's more of a fix than it is an actual, like, solution. Yeah. That's why, like, over time, comics don't go up. Like, they don't sell more. So it's like, just commit to having the numbers and, you know, just like,
Yeah, they just, you know, need a little boost. Throw a number one out there. Fuck it. All right. What do we got next? Let's see. Okay. Looks like we got Power Girl number 7s from DC Comics. This is the Susan Micah cover. We're going to talk more about that, too, here a little later on. I can't remember even what the fuck happened in the last issue of Power Girl.
This book is not very good. I'm not going to lie. Yeah, I love Power Girl, but I don't like reading this book.
Yeah,
so I don't even buy it anymore. I dropped the book off my pull list because I know that I'm going to get a variant for each of the issues because there's always a good variant for Power Girl because it's Power Girl. So I just buy the variants now. Like, I don't even really, like, I'll read it when I get to it eventually, but I stopped caring for this one. It's not good. And she's still in the JSA book, and she's great there. So,
yeah. Yeah, this is it. It hasn't been my favorite series from DC by far either, but the cover definitely a great one. Would you picking this one up too?
No, absolutely not. Sorry, guys. Yeah, not right. Even for the cover.
Okay. How about this one?
That one I'd be a little more inclined to pick up.
There you go, Harley 38. So this is obviously going to be a big one this week. Everybody's after this. This Harley cover for some reason. I don't know what it could be. I mean, I guess.
Dude, I got like three of these. It's just a good cover. Like,
honestly, it is. It's fantastic.
Yeah, I gotta take it when you can. And there's no ratio bullshit version of this. There's no foil, nothing. There's just this is the cover. So,
not yet. Not yet. There will be. It's inevitable.
DC doesn't do it as much as Marvel. Like they do sometimes, but there's nowhere near like as bad as Marvel with the like reprinting it with a ratio like second print ratio virgin version. Like, they don't do that.
Right.
Yeah.
What's going on? This is another one. I mean, I love Harley, but the series itself has just been kind of for me lately.
I'm not gonna lie. I haven't read it in like 10 issues, but there is like a few issues where Zatanna is gonna be in them, like one or two. I think the annual is Zatanna doing some. Yeah, I'll read those because I love Zatanna. But like, I flipped through this book and I don't know what the fuck is going on. But like, I just looked through at the LCS.
Well, I read it.
It looked cool though, like because it's like it's showing you like different versions of Harley and the artwork changes for each Harley and shit. Like I thought that was cool. But like, admittedly, like I didn't read it, so I don't know what's going on. But like, the book looks cool. So I don't know. I think part of the reason this book turns me off is because it's a $5 book, and in my opinion, like I love Harley Quinn. And I know she has a really committed audience, but this book doesn't sell like a huge print and then account run. Like, it's not one of the top sellers anymore. Yeah. And I feel like it's hard to justify $5 for this book. I don't care about a backup story. Like, I'd rather, you know what I mean? Like, I'd rather just get another like $4 title or something.
Yeah. Just keep relaunching Harley and eventually.
No. I'm glad they're not relaunching her at least. Like, it's cool that she's like 38.
It's about time.
Well, this is his art. I'm pretty sure this is like one of her longer ongoings. Like, it's getting up there to the new 52 like length. So if we pass 50 issues with this one, it might be her longest ongoing. So yeah.
Yeah, you might be right. I think she had one that was like 75 issues. But other than that, I think this is probably her second longest or whatever. It's just, I don't know. It's kind of falling off for me, but whatever. Hopefully it'll pick up again. All right. This one's been anticipated this week.
Oh,
we got X-Men 97 number one. Of course, we'll be talking more about that later too. Man, I'm sure we're all picking this one up, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
How about this? I honestly, like, I don't know if I'll stick with the book. Like, I'll give it a chance because I don't really, I don't really care for the X-Men, to be honest, but... But like, I'll just buy number one. Yeah. So.
Yeah. No, I'm picking this up for sure.
Yeah. And well, we'll get into the actual show a little later on, obviously. I don't know if it's going to be a direct like adaptation of the show or anything like that. Oh, maybe like they'll do some more original stories in that same universe, but
yeah,
probably the adaptation.
Yeah, keep it keep it separate.
Yeah,
as much as you can.
We'll see.
I think that's what helped me buy it was the cover. I think is it Todd Knock? It looks like Todd Knock.
Yeah, I think so.
But yeah, like that alone just sold me on it. I just really love his stuff, and it was like an X-Men 97 cover by Todd Knock. Just looks sweet with all of them. The composition of the cover is great. They're all there. They all like have a prominent spot on the cover. So I was like, hell yeah, I'm sold.
Hey, AOA, what's going on?
Hey, Andy, hey.
It's the best group of X-Men. Like,
this is honestly. Yeah, that's my team right there. That's what I grew up with.
Right?
Yeah.
All right. Let's see what else we got. Okay, we got Edge of Spider-Verse 2. Threw this on here because I guess we're going to get a new version of, we're probably several new versions of Spider-Man. I guess this one is Spooky Man.
Like, come on.
I saw the cover of this and I was like, you know what? I'm not even gonna bother buying this. There's so much of this book, like the last two volumes of the book at my local comic shop, so many different copies. Yeah. Like, everyone thinks like they're gonna get another Spider-Gwen these days, and it's just like, guys, like, I don't know about anyone else, but I'm like, personally, I was thinking about this and I was like, I'm actually enjoying Ultimate Spider-Man, of course. I'm enjoying Spider-Boy a lot. Like, I'm still buying that book. I'm really enjoying it. And it's like, I don't even know if I want to read more spider characters. Just like so many. Yeah. Like, my police is going to go from like, again, the people who buy all the X-Men books, and soon it's going to be like all the Spider-Man books because there's so many. And I have Spectacular Spider-Man. So that one was also good. So it's just like, it's going to get out of hand. And yeah, like, I just looked at the title and like Spooky Man, and he just looks like a generic like symbiote ass like character. You know what I mean? Like, come on. Like, if I hear later on it's like, oh, it's worth reading or something, I'll check it out. But I bought the first issue of this, and that Weapon 8 thing, I did not like it. I'm not going to lie.
They just slapped the Venom colors on Carnage and called it a fucking day.
And they did the same thing with Weapon 8. It's just Cyclops. Like, it's Cyclops colors on, like, some weird generic spider character. And just, like, yeah, is with, that like, really...
shit on, throwing there. And then, new Spider-Man.
Hero was saying the X-Men 97 comic is a prequel to the show.
Oh, okay, yeah. Cool.
Then maybe I'll keep up with it, yeah. Don't give me none of that Mandalorian crap where you're just, it's like panel for panel.
The same thing. Yeah, that was,
That was, yeah.
But I gotta agree with Phil. You know, at this point, Ultimate Spidey, there's nothing you need to know. Just open the comic and fucking read it, you know.
And there's no like 10 million Spider-Men. You know what I mean? Watering down like Peter Parker, you know, it's just there's the one Spider-Man, so it feels
but great. You know what they should have done with that Weapon 8 that I think would have been a winner? He should have shot fucking webbing out of his eyes, bro. That would have been a way to go. It would have been a way to go. Come on, man.
Swinging from his face. Like, you know, like
face. I mean, why not? Face, I'm sorry, man.
Move this man!
It had to happen.
All right. Next up, we've got... Okay.
What's the deal? First of all, this was a book. This already came out. Like, yes, this whole thing already exists. It was an OGN. It's cheap as well. Like, you can buy this on Amazon right now. You can find it in a comic shop, probably. I'm not, like, too sure. I'm not even upset or anything. I'm just, like, genuinely curious why this exists in this format. Like, this already exists. Like, why were they like, oh, we gotta do the single issues, you know?
I have no idea. The only thing that I could think of was maybe there's a chance that they're getting ready to use her somewhere else.
They've used her. She was in like Titans Academy, Teen Titans.
But I mean, like
Academy
actually give her issues. Like a, you know, like maybe a push, maybe. Like a series, or put her on a team or something like that.
It wasn't like for kids. I would recommend this. Like for kids, if you want to get your kids like a fun book, your kids like 12 years old or younger, maybe 10 years old or younger. Like this was a fun book, but it's like for adults, like I don't recommend it. It's a kid's book. It's like a young audience book. So
and like you said, the graphic novel, I mean, it came out like a year ago or more.
No, maybe. No, way more. Like almost 3-4 years ago, like that.
Yeah, was it that long ago? Shit.
Yeah. Like 2 or 3 years ago. No, 2 or 3 years ago. Yeah.
And there was never any comic book release or anything like that. But like she said, she has shown up a few places, but yeah, this is gonna be. How do you think that would affect it? It could just.
I'm curious to see. Like, I really am, because I've read the book. I have the book, so I'm not gonna get the comic, but because like it'd be redundant. But I'm curious to see if it sells well or if it finds a new audience in the comic book format. Who knows? I don't know. Okay. But I think it's strange, though.
Yeah, it is very, very strange. All right. So next up, we've got. This one is for you, dude.
Man. Power Rangers still going on, guys. We're at issue 118. Dark Spectre is here. Shit's going down. I know. I've been saying this for weeks, guys, but they just keep prolonging it. This battle just never seems to end. But I think we're just about there. A lot of the Rangers are getting captured right now, turned over to these, I guess you could call them Death Rangers. Mm-hmm. Not going to call them Zombie Rangers.
Right, because they ain't Zombie Rangers.
They ain't Zombie Rangers, exactly. They're like Death Rangers.
The cover is a misrepresentation.
Right. The
cover's bait. It's bait.
It is. They baited me. I got it.
Yeah, so Dark Spectre taking everyone over. Their only hope left is Kimberly, the Ranger Slayer from the alternate universe. And
Kimberly, the Ranger Slayer? Is this Power Rangers Buffy? Is that what the shit is?
No, Power Rangers Buffy.
That literally just sounds like Power Rangers Buffy.
You got to read it first. You got to read it.
Hey, man. Buffy's awesome, okay? I'm not disrespecting Buffy.
It's not
What's not that?
That different, necessarily.
not that different. But, no, it's coming to a nice ending here. So I'm curious to see how they're going to wrap it up and what comes next. So,
and maybe we'll get some real Zombie Rangers.
No, we won't. But there is another helmet cover.
I swear to God, it's going to be like, we're going to be like 2 years from now, Brandon's gonna be like, "Oh, it's MMPR 150 big anniversary," and it's still somehow gonna be a fucking Behrens cover.
I know, and they're still fighting that final battle too. It's been going on for about 20 years.
How many covers is Behrens done? Like, no disrespect to him, like, that's insane. He's done so many for Spawn and Power Rangers. Like, is it like over 20 at this point for Power Rangers? Or?
Maybe almost at 20.
Wow, that's insane, man.
Yeah, I want to say since like issue 100, he's been doing them for Power Rangers.
Okay.
Yeah.
Damn. It'll probably be at, you know, whatever issue 150, and there still won't be no damn Zombie Rangers.
No, there won't be. Anyway. Yeah, that was rough. That was a rough blow, that movie. But now we're still around. Fans are still around, man.
Yeah, that movie was rough.
Ooh.
All right. Yeah. So we got Pharaoh number one coming out from Image Comics. This is the, what is it, Day of the Dead, Dawn of the Dead? One of them. Mm-hmm. I can't remember which one. Homage covers, because of course we're gonna do that again. We've got another.
Oh, dude, they're gonna milk the hell out of
They are.
It's just gonna be overall, like that's one of the things I didn't like about this book the last time they did it, was try, like, they really milked the movie thing. And like, I watched an interview recently where Tony Felix was like, "Oh, we're not gonna do that this time around," but it's like, I don't believe you. It's just so I don't believe you because
looking at the solicitations for it, I mean, there's already a fuck ton of covers for it, so I mean, yeah, it seems like that's exactly what they're doing again already. I mean, to say they're not going to do it as big as Stray Dogs, because it's not going to sell as well as Stray Dogs. It's just not, like.
Yeah. I mean, I'm excited for it. I'll definitely give it a shot, but it's just like, it does feel gimmicky, and I hope I'm proven wrong. Like, I hope when I read it, I'm just like, this isn't just the guy who's trying to get, like, you know, points doing this, like, the same kind of deal again. But when I heard him talk about it in interviews, it seemed like a really cool premise. So
that's the thing. I mean, so, like, I'm gonna get it, and I hope it's good too, obviously. But it does obviously have that very similar feel to Stray Dogs. So there's gonna be people that did enjoy Stray Dogs that wait and see, you know, how it is, or if it's the same basic thing.
I agree with Phil. Like, Stray Dogs was a quiet sleeper. This is not. I agree. But if you look, like, Stray Dogs had a lot of, like, exclusives. This one doesn't have as many exclusives this time going around. So it's almost like the market is cautious as well. So either way, like, it'll be cool just reading it. Like, I'm definitely excited to read it. This is a good creative team, and like, they did nail it the first time. And cats are fun. So let's see what they do.
Hopefully they'll make the cats the killers or something. And this one, that would be a different twist. We shall see. I think we have one more book up here. Yes, there we go. We had to throw this one on here for Mr. Baker. We've got Sam and Twitch Case Files, number one from Image Comics. So we're going to get a comic for Sam and Twitch. You know, the two cops from... the Spawn universe. I went with this cover because these covers always strike me as fucking weird. You have the, like, two cops standing there. They're shooting in two different directions, looking very relaxed. I mean, that's just... I feel like if they had the need to shoot in separate directions, they probably wouldn't be that relaxed on the cover, you know? Just throwing it out there. But it is pretty cool. I do like it, the black and white there. I think it's the McFarlane cover. Yeah.
It's a sweet cover. I think it looks really nice with the title and the logo up the top. It really, yeah, like, it's like, it goes together really nicely. So it's exciting for a Spawn fan. I feel like if you're a Spawn fan, you're like, it's Christmas right now for you, because you're getting all these, like, titles and everything.
Chino.
Yeah.
Chino.
There's, like, I think there was, like, four new ones that were coming, right? Something like that.
Rat City, this one, and like one or two other ones. Yeah. There's quite a few. Yeah.
Definitely a pickup for me. And I think that's the last one we got. Yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
All right. Go ahead and pop out of there. And, not too bad this week. Nothing too crazy. Yeah, for sure. He's building the damn universe. Make it too excited. Right. Building a universe of Spawn books, for that's for sure. All right. So I guess we'll go ahead and let's do some voting next. We'll vote on some shit. What do you think?
All right.
Round one, fight. Test your might. Test your might.
You win. I thought my asking for forgiveness last week would maybe, you know, not give us a copyright strike. Yeah, we got it again.
Nah,
fuck them. But hey, we're gonna do it again.
Right?
Yeah.
All right. So now we're into the second round, and so these are the winners from our first round. Getting paired up, and so these are gonna be a little rougher than the first round matchups. As you can see, started it off for the first one. We've got a little Cyclops Jean Grey taking on Superman and Lois. So, dude, if you want to go ahead and throw us a little line in chat there, we'll go ahead.
Absolutely.
Let them vote on their favorite couple. And we'll start with Sheik. Which one you like out of these two? Which is your couple?
I do really respect Cyclops and Jean Grey, but I got to give it to Supes and Lois. Like, they've just, overall, I just think their relationship is better. They're more iconic. They've had a more stable relationship. Their child hasn't committed mass atrocities, or you know what I mean, or you know, ever fucked with the Phoenix Force.
That time.
So yeah, I think the chat just being a lot of Marvelites, I think they're gonna go with Cyclops and Jean, but like realistically, like let's be honest,
the Marvelites, I love it,
yeah, let's be honest. Is there iconic moments like Supes Lois, right? Like you think about Superman 78 and you think about those scenes in that movie, like when he catches her, right? When she's like, who's holding you? Whatever, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like, you got me, who's got you? It's like, you think there's an iconic moment like that for Cyclops and Jean on the big screen? Like, yeah, like there's some moments from them in the original X trilogy, but like animated, it's a different story, but I'm talking like, you think they reached that
I see why you said that.
Yeah, no, but like even I would say even animated, I would say Superman and Lois are better. Like when you look at My Adventures with Superman, like dude, you're laughing, but like you watched one X-Men animated show. There's like over 15 Superman animated shows that span from the 60s to now. Like that, it's not even comparable. Like you know what I mean? Like, so it's like even then, like, and it's like My Adventures with Superman, the newest show, did a really good job of pushing Lois, especially for a kid show, pushing Lois like as a super central character. But like again, there's no disrespect to the Cyclops and Phoenix. Like I feel like if it was, you know, any other cover, any other couple, like, even if it was like Batman Catwoman, I probably would have gone the Cyclops and Phoenix, but with Superman and Lois, it's like, come on, like, you know.
All right. So, dude, who are you taking on this one?
Honestly, I got to completely agree with Sheik. That's America's favorite couple right there, you know. Superman and Lois, that's the perfect couple, you know. And Cyclops and Jean, they have their ups and downs. I just got to pick my favorite. They've been strong right throughout, you know. You always look up to them. You're like, oh, nice, you know. So, I got to go Superman and Lois all day.
I mean, I understand what you guys are saying. And I'm inclined to agree with everything that you're saying. On the other hand, I will say this for Cyclops. Dude lost his chick and went and got her fucking clone. That is commitment to the bit, my friend. I mean,
that's a bit psychotic.
A little creepy too, to be honest, but
yeah,
hey,
yeah, you know,
whatever.
Not if we ban you first.
Yeah, I mean, and then after, when he lost her again, he went out and just replaced her with some other psychic chick. So like, he's definitely got a type, I guess.
Here's the deal breaker. Okay, here's the deal breaker. It's gonna hurt you Marvelites out there, even though I love Marvel, but it's the truth. Rachel Summers has been around since the 80s. Oh. Okay, John Kent's been around since the fucking 2000s, and way more people know who John Kent is than Rachel Summers. Okay, fight me right now if you don't think that's true. Okay, like John Kent's here, Rachel Summers here. It's not even close. Like it's like she's not even like remotely in the
could
same.
You,
so it's like
make
when
it,
you look
could
at
you
it,
make
like,
an argument for John Kent versus Cable though, because it's sort of Gene's kid almost.
That's not fair. I mean, even I would say John Kent's still more popular than Cable for the most part.
He probably
maybe
is
not, like by this point, I would say 100%. I would say John Kent's more popular than Cable at this point. Yeah,
well, it must have been like, when they finally got a kid after 80 years.
Because Cable has one trick, so like most of his stories are the same. Like he's just so it's like at the end of the day, there's not much you can do with him. And they tried making him young, and that lasted, you know, for a while, and then they just brought him back. It was fun when he was chasing the twin chick. I forget her name. The one who was like the sidekick of Emma Frost. You know, the twin like lab chicks. I forget who their name.
Oh yeah, yeah, the Stepford Cuckoos.
Yeah. It was fun when he was chasing them and shit like that. But like after a while, you kind of get sick of it. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Yeah.
All right. Well, it looks like in this case,
it's Superman Lois
is taking it
all day.
Yeah, I'm telling you, if it was anyone else, I would have given it to probably Cyclops and Phoenix. But Superman Lois, that's like the Mount Rushmore.
Yeah, that's a tough one to beat. Yeah. All right. So for our second matchup this week, we've got Daredevil and Elektra taking on
Harley. This one's easy. Parker. Easy.
And we went theme this week. We've got all the weddings.
Ooh,
we've got all the weddings.
Yeah, I love that book on the right.
There's a little wedding thing there.
Yeah.
So, we'll start it off with dude this time. Which one are you taking? Actually, you want to go ahead and throw the line in there? While you're...
Yeah. Let me do that. Let Sheet go.
Yeah, we'll go ahead and let Sheet start. He said it's easy. So which one you got?
Sheet? Wait, am I going for? Okay, I'll go with Daredevil Elektra. So. Look, Harley Joker is the most toxic couple in like comic books. One of the most like there's like toxic relationships where they kind of work because they're both just insane characters. I don't think this is one of them because when you look at the arc like Harley has had, there is a very it's like parabolic evolution, right? There's ups and downs, but right. I would say for the most part, it's moving upwards towards like the positive side. Like she's always been kind of rehabilitating. I would say more so than Poison Ivy, who is actually towards the negative side. Like, yeah, she has her moments, ups and downs, but I think she's always leaning more towards being a villain. Whereas with Harley, especially I would say in the last 10 years and very much so in the last 5 years, they've really like leaned on her being a superhero or just at least like someone kind of like a Deadpool where it's like, you're not evil, but you do questionable things, but you're still doing more positive things than you are negative. And I think she's understood as well, like how bad Joker is for her, and they've separated right all this time. Like she's moved on, she's been with Poison Ivy for a long time, and so I think like this couple doesn't really work. It's just it really doesn't anymore, and I don't think it ever will go back to like the only way I can see them doing Harley and Joker in the future is if they're doing like what they're doing for the musical,
right.
Or if they're doing like just certain moments in time.
Flashback
but I think story. If you, I think if you changed Harley back right now. To the way she was with Joker, I think a lot of people, especially Harley fans, feel offended because they'll be like, you did all this development and then you just threw it away, like just to put her back
right
here.
Rightfully so,
Yeah, exactly. So it's like, I don't think she'll ever go back to that. And it's like, if you remember Joker War, she's the one who shot Joker in the eye. So she's the reason he had to replace his eye and she wanted to kill him. Like literally Batman had to like bust ass to save his life that day. She wanted to straight up murder him. She tried. So it's like, this is not a couple, but Daredevil and Elektra, they're like an amazing couple. And even though they've had their rough patches as well, I feel like even when they're not like necessarily a relationship couple where they're like, partners, they're still partners in crime and they're still partners in the legacy. And he's kind of welcomed her into the legacy in the last run. So, and she's taken over even individually for a while. And they're always going to be a team dynamic there that works between the two. And when you really think about when she died back in the day, it was more of a tragedy, right? Like they were super in love. So I don't know. I really like that relationship. So I'll give it to Daredevil Elektra any day over Joker Harley.
All right. Dude, who you got?
I got to be honest. I'm not too well versed with Daredevil and Elektra's history. So my answer is going to be biased, right? Okay. And Sheik, you just, you know. You tore it right down. I was going to go Harley and Joker all day just because of how chaotic, unpredictable they were, right? But if we talk about how they are right now and the evolution that they've gone through in history, right? No, you're completely right. They wouldn't work at all, right? They've gone their separate ways, and they're too different for each other. But I still got to pick them just because I'm not versed enough with their.
That's fair. I respect it.
For me personally, I think both these couples suck, to be honest. I mean, like, they're not good couples. I mean, obviously, you know, Harley and Joker stories are always fun to read and everything like that. But obviously, they're not a very good couple. They're very bad for each other. You know, and I feel like people would lean more towards, like, Ivy and Harley at this point. Like you said, she or Joker and Punchline at this point, potentially. Because even though she's not that old, you know, she got a lot of publicity pretty early. So, you know, people know who she is. With Daredevil and Elektra, I mean, like I said, Daredevil, he's kind of had numerous different past excursions besides Elektra. Elektra has been on both sides of the law at different times. So they just kind of, they sort of stack up in the same way, but on opposite sides of the spectrum. If I had to pick one as far as like a story to read, I would pick Harley and Joker. But as far as being like a successful couple, yeah, I guess at this point you have to give the edge to Daredevil and Elektra because they're together. So there's that. And it looks like the chat is going with Daredevil and Elektra by a landslide. So, all right. That's what we got for this week on the cock. And we... got a little bit more for you next week. All right, let's see what else we got. Oh, we got some news here, don't we?
We do.
Yeah, got a couple.
TNN! Nowhere close to an actual news network.
Not a lot of news this week. Oh, she had to dip out. So, just me and Dude to finish this up. But that's not a problem because... thank God, in a way, because this news that we got is not one that any of us were really wanting to talk about on some of it here. So I know Sheik was not looking forward to, not this one, the next one. We only have two bits of news for you, but Sheik was not looking forward to the next part at all. So, oh, he's coming back. Okay, cool.
Yeah, he's coming back.
All right. Well,
but then he's gonna dip out.
Yeah, he'll be back just in time to not miss it. Then even better. All right. So first up, we've got the Resurrection Protocol. X-Men are back. Obviously, March 20th started the new series. You've seen it, right, dude?
Oh, I've seen it, man.
And tell us what you thought.
It's everything you hoped and dreamed it would be. It's like they never missed a day. It meshes so nice. You got the same opening. Everything's kind of updated, but kind of the same. The only way I can describe it from what I've noticed myself is like the backgrounds and everything, like the stills are all the same kind of animation, but the characters themselves are a little more like smoother, I guess you could say, with the movements and a little more clear. So it's a little more updated in the forefront.
Okay.
But it's great. It's got the same feel to it. And, I think we're in for a treat here, guys. I don't want to say it, you know, jinx us because it's Marvel, it's Disney, but I think we're on to something here. So let's hold on to it. Magneto, the man went through some shit. He's dealing with some shit, and he's trying. All I'm gonna say is he's trying to turn a new page here, and some people just. They don't see it, right? So he's got a monologue towards the end. Marvel was telling me about it. Archel was telling me about it. So when I checked it out for myself, I was like, damn, okay, that's powerful. There was a really powerful speech he gave. And I'm in, guys. The writing's good. The animation is good. What else do we need?
Right. Sheik, we thought you were getting out of here before the next... next slide to avoid it.
No. Oh no. I watched the show. I was into it. It was really good. I was concerned.
You have seen it?
Yeah, I was concerned that they weren't gonna like keep true to the spirit of the original one, which that was my biggest concern. But no, that was those concerns were gone immediately when like 5 minutes into the beginning. Honestly, the moment I heard the music for the intro, right. I was like, we're back. And yeah, it was really good. It was well written. I like how they adapted the certain issues really well. Like you could see pretty much a lot of uncanny X-Men number 200 in the second episode, and they even kept Magneto in the same costume
for when he, the trial of Magneto. Yeah
exactly. So it was really cool, and I like to see his locks.
Yeah, it's new look. I like it. I like it.
Yeah, it's cool. No, it was awesome. I'm really looking forward to it's nice having another animated show that's either like, you know, I wanted to watch something Marvel or DC. I was enjoying My Adventures with Superman, and then I wanted something from Marvel. So it's nice having X-Men 97 to watch while there's also like Invincible. So it's a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah. Invincible's good too.
Yeah. Wonder if we'll get a Batman 97 anytime.
There's rumors about Batman.
Batman, The Adventures Return.
Right. Exactly.
It's like they're going to get it. Yeah. That would be a lot. I would. They are doing the. That other one, I forget what it's called. There's like the one with the Amazon or whatever. So I'm excited for that. But yeah, Cape Crusader, I think is what it's called. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. And we're getting Creature Commando. So, but we'll get into that little argument a little bit later on. All right. So we'll go ahead and just move over to the next slide. This is going to be a good one. Yeah, so CGC has acquired James Spence authentication services, which obviously they authenticate autographs and, you know, the like. So they are going to, I don't know if they are accepting. I've seen some posts that said they are accepting already.
Already?
Get authenticated. Not but quite. Yeah, I don't know if I haven't seen anything official from CGC yet.
So, yeah, there's got to be some transition time between you.
I would think so.
Yeah.
What do you think? What's your impression of this, dude?
I don't know. I've heard both sides of the conversation of this, and I don't know if anyone's gonna agree with me here. But honestly, I see what they're trying to do. You know, they've been through some shit, guys. Just like any other business, you know, may deal with at some point. May or may not, right? But shit happens. They're trying different things. They're trying to, you know, bring in customers. They got to crack down on, you know, the fraud and the switching out books, a couple things, right? Mm-hmm. But they're trying new things. You know, CBSA was the only one that would authenticate without a witness. Now they're going to be able to do it too. Why not? You know, it's just a business move.
Yeah, it is. What do you think, Sheik?
Honestly, like, I think it's really, like, one thing everyone should ask themselves is why it's particularly interesting that they're, like, pushing. Basically, they're putting everything out there once they were in the shitter. You know what I mean? Once there's a lot of controversy, they started really innovating and being like, oh, yeah, we're going to try to do this now and do that. And it's like, I think this is cool because it's something that a lot of people have asked for from CGC before, right? Like, it kind of sucks getting a green label on something you know should be a yellow label. So in that sense, I think it's pretty cool. Not having to have a witness, like, all the time, I think is pretty cool. Yeah. It kind of puts – I think competition is always helpful for the industry. So this encourages CBCS to step up their product, which they've been doing a lot of. But, yeah, there's – like you guys said, there's a lot more factors to consider when it comes to this. I'm more personally concerned about the whole like 9.9 pre-submission or whatever the fuck they're called, pre-screen submissions and all that. Yeah, like that to me is a lot more problematic than this. This actually is good, so in my opinion. So yeah.
I wonder if they have a plan for how they're going to address any comic that they've already graded with a green label, you know, that has a signature on it.
Yeah, I guess I agree from the monopolization point of view that it's bad, but it's like CGC already has a monopoly on the market. And it's not just a monopoly in terms of like, I think more important, it's like Apple, where it's like the default that people go to,
Like, it's just exactly. Like everyone
want to be the default, right?
Exactly. Yeah. They have it automatically. Yeah. Like no, like you. It's like it's not even considered. It's not like Samsung where like there's a healthy amount of people that buy like Samsung phone. It's like people who do CBCS instead of CGC. It's almost like they're rebels. Like that's the point of view that exists within the community. You know what I mean? It's almost like they're like hipsters because like CGC has such a dominance already, and they have like a psychological dominance too. Like, even if all this controversy came out, some of the graders were doing this bullshit, people still swear by them. And it's like, you have to understand, people have vested interest in this because they have so many, like, especially the people who submit all the time, whether it's like a weekly business or monthly business that does pre-submissions or whatever, or if they have like really high-end graded books, like their bottom line is gets hurt when CGC's credibility goes down. So it's like, they're going to back CGC no matter what. So it's like, I can't see... I don't know how CBCS could ever honestly like claw their way back from something like this.
CGC out there buying every fucking cheap CBCS autograph that they can find on the market right now, hoping they can get them authenticated. Oh, no, this ain't real.
like Michael Baker, for example, has a lot of CGC slabs, right? Like, do you think even if we have definitive proof that CBCS is somehow like better, you think like he's gonna suddenly just abandon like the 3,000 slabs that he has that are CGC and just switch like pivot to CBCS? Like it's gonna take something drastic, and it's like that kind of change happens through experimentation and all that. Like even like you guys said, most people like there's the common saying that it's like people pay more for CGC. Like that's just it's just like the label itself, the slab gets you more money. So it's like it is what it is, right?
Yeah.
Nowhere bound. I mean, maybe it shouldn't necessarily be that way. You would hope that there would be some sort of consistency in grading so that there should be consistency in the market.
Now, like actual, yeah, I agree.
Yeah, it just doesn't
go that look way. At Marvel.
That's
right?
All anybody wants, right? Is just a consistent grading scale where it's not going to differ from one company you send to the next.
That's true. That's true.
Fuck. Yeah.
Good luck with that, though.
I know. It's wild.
We couldn't even go back to the old scale, you know, the mint, near mint and everything, because that's fucking arbitrary, too. So, I mean.
Exactly.
It is what it is. I don't know. I mean, I don't have any green labels. So, it's not going to affect me. But I know if I did have a green label, like, that was the first thing that I thought of about this. It's like, I would be kind of irritated hearing this if I had a green label comic. Like if I had, you know, I don't know, a Stanley signature, but it was green label or something like that. I'd probably be pretty. Yeah,
I have one. I have a Justice League New 52 number one signed by Jeff Johns and Jim Lee, and it's green label. So it's like, because it wasn't witnessed. So maybe I'll resubmit it and get a yellow label because it's like the only Jim Lee signature that I have. So
yeah, that's the thing. Wow. Like now you have to submit it again. Like you basically have no choice.
They got me by the balls. They got me by the spine ticks. You know?
They just got you for that extra submission cost.
Yeah, they got me by the staples. Seriously.
Yeah.
Right. But what can you do? That's pretty small share of the market, I would think. So we'll see. We'll see. I'm sure there will be controversy all along as it plays out.
That's what one of the C's in CGC stands for, baby.
Right? Yeah. That's actually all the news that we got for this week. It's a light news week. Not too much.
Yeah, not much.
We have one last little bit for you here. We've got... got a couple trades in keeping with the animated theme tonight. We will start it off with this one. As I said, we can get into the little animated versus battle later on. Because we got this. Marvel animated versus DC animated. We got Spider-Man Adventures number one versus Batman Adventures number one. So which one you guys taking? Dude, we'll go ahead and start with you on this one.
First off, I don't own either of these books. So, I got to find these. Yeah, I know.
Okay. They're not too expensive.
But I grew up with both of these, if you know what I mean. Fuck, man. I'm actually going to go Batman on this.
Oh, okay.
I just Batman animated was the shit back in the day. Spider-Man, it was good. It was there, you know. It's just, I don't know, it just wasn't as cool, as dark, as gritty as Batman, you know. Just, yeah, gotta go Batman Adventures on this.
Okay, all right. Sheik, which one are you taking?
Okay, so honestly, I love both of these shows, but if we're being objective, like objectively honest, and I love Spider-Man, I really do. Like, two of my favorite characters of all time right here. The Batman show is a lot better. Like, it's not saying the Spider-Man show is not good, and that's not what I'm saying at all. The Spider-Man show is excellent. It's great. But it's more of a kid's show, whereas, like, I feel, and it didn't age as well in the sense that it doesn't hold up. Like, you can still watch it, but, like, it's very, I don't know, the pacing is weird. Like, you could tell it's made for kids.
The internal monologue. Internal monologue throughout.
Exactly. It's also silly, but in a good way. Like, it's really fun. I love it. And I collect the comics. Like, I really enjoy that one. But the Batman Adventures is, like, iconic. Like, I would argue, like, that's the best take on Batman, like, ever. Like, ever. Like, ever made, in my personal opinion, that's the best take on Batman, period. Like,
yeah.
To the point where, like, ever since then, it's influenced so much media. Because I think as someone who's read, like, all of Detective, all of Batman, all of Legends of the Dark Knight, all of Shadow, like, all that shit, I think they took the best of everything and they amalgamated it in that TV show, in the adventures. And those comics are excellent. Like, they're made for kids, but they actually read so well for adults too. Like, I own that book in multiple formats, including Omnibus, single issue, like, you name it. Nice. I love it. And I would say that, like, I'm a big, big DC fan because of the animated series. And I would say I'm a big, big Spider-Man fan because of the Adventure series. But I would honestly, in terms of comic, I would go with Adventures, Spider-Man Adventures, because I don't have that, but I do have Batman. But in terms of TV show, I would give it to, like, Adventures, Batman Adventures, just because I feel like that one just holds up better. But I feel like you can't really go wrong with either of these. Like, they're both, I would love to have both. I want both of these.
Yeah, now, exactly.
Now I have to find the Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's what I would go with, because I have Batman.
All right. So if you would have asked me, I guess, a while back, I would have pretty easily had said Batman Adventures number one without hesitation. But after, you know, plans for the new X-Men series and everything like that, came about, one of the things that I do remember from the Spider-Man series from the 90s is that it kind of, like, ended on a cliffhanger. They, like, Mary Jane got sucked through a fucking portal or something like that, and then I think that was how the series ended. And there's kind of been, like, a little bit of talk that they may at some point do a Spider-Man series, you know, to kind of go follow in the footsteps, I guess, of, you know, like X-Men 97. So, I don't know. Maybe that gives a little bit more value to the Spider-Man comic. I guess it probably make me think about it for a minute or two, but I still have to lean towards Batman on it. I mean, it's just, Batman was so good. Like you said, it was basically the best version of Batman.
Yeah. Dude, they have like, the cast is insane. They have fucking Mark Hamill playing Joker. They have Kevin Conroy, who's, like, let's be real, Kevin Conroy is the best Batman. Dude, when I read Batman, that's the voice I hear when Batman talks. It's like Kevin Conroy. They have, like, this incredible cast, and I still watch this shit till this day. Like, I'm not kidding. I watch it all the time. Like, that show is so good, and it's like, it's so good. They made Mask of the Phantasm a theatrical movie, dude. Like,
he really did.
I mean, the show, like, for kids was perfect. It's the perfect thing to get kids into Spider-Man. But yeah, it's not made with the same level of quality. And they just didn't have, like, an insane cast like Batman did. Like, insane. I still can't believe, like, this Batman show exists, because it's that good. You know what I mean? Like, it's that good.
Yep. I agree. All right. So we're going to go ahead. We got one more, and we're going to stick with the animated theme, but we're going to have a little battle of first appearances.
Oh, yeah.
So we've got X-Men Adventures number one. This is giving us the first appearance of Morph taking on Superman Adventures number five, giving us the first appearance of Livewire. I'm going to go with you first again, dude, on this one. I'm doing it for a reason, too. So, go ahead.
Because you know my answer already.
I know what you're doing.
Livewire is cool, guys. Don't get me wrong. Love the character, especially in the animated series. I do not own this issue. However, I don't know what it is about this X-Men Adventures 1 cover, but every time I see it, I pick it up. Doesn't matter. You know, as long as it's for a half decent price, I will pick it up. I love the cover. I think I got like six or seven copies kicking around. I will continue to pick it up. I just love it. So I gotta go X-Men all day. And we talked about it earlier when we talked about the news. X-Men Adventures is it's my shit.
All right, Sheik, which one are you going with?
Okay, so I do love the X-Men Adventures. I have that book, and I do love the Superman Adventures. I have that book. But that Superman Adventures, bro, that's written by what's his name? I forget his name. It's like I'm gonna Google this. I swear it's Scott McCloud. Scott McCloud, that's his name. It's written by Scott McCloud, who, if you know, he's the guy who wrote the Understanding Comics and all that. So I really loved that era of Superman Adventures. And I thought Livewire was a really brilliant character. I think she has an amazing design. Morph, I feel like, is a generic character. Like, he's really there just to save them budget because they can't probably put all of the other ones at the same time. So they just have him do that. I do think Morph is cool, but he's a lot like Ditto, like the Pokemon Ditto, right? Like, he's just very, like, a generic character.
That's the whole point, man.
Yeah. So, like, I do enjoy Morph, but, like, I got to give it to Livewire because I think, like, Livewire's that cover, bro, that cover's amazing. And even the Adventures cover is really good, but I think, I don't know, something about that Livewire, just her appearing. It was an exciting time because that was the time of Harley Quinn, and people, they thought they caught lightning in a bottle again with this character, literally. So it's cool to see, like, Livewire, and she's still around. Like, she's still a big part of DC to the point where, even her first appearance in the mainline DC is like a key. So, yeah, I'll go with the Livewire. But I love both of these books. So, yeah.
Fair enough. All right. If I knew nothing about either book, I would actually go with the first appearance of Livewire. I like the cover more. I have the X-Men Adventures, of course. It's pretty easy to find. And that's actually a big factor to consider in these two. The Superman Adventures 5 is actually a lot harder to find, to the point where, it's probably about like a, I don't know, maybe about like a $30 book versus the X-Men being maybe $20 or so.
Oh, it was a dollar book all day for the last couple
of years.
Pick them up for a dollar.
So, you know.
Yeah. Well, that's fair.
So that's, I would go with the Livewire.
Damn. Yeah. All right.
Fun character too from the animated series. I couldn't put anything up against fucking Harley because there is nothing in the animated world that even, you know,
She'd win all day, bud.
Yeah, like it's not all close. Like,
not even one iota.
So that was my options. It was like Livewire and Morph, and I was like, they're kind of close in price, but maybe. Yeah.
You could have done the Rocket Chick, the Batman. You know, the Batman animated series. That one would have been more. Yeah, because that one's like nobody knows her. So
I don't fucking know her.
That's true. There's like, you'd have had to have seen it.
Yep.
I think she was in like, I think two episodes, right? Or was it Superman?
Yeah, she was in like two or three, and then they tried to like. That was like them trying to make another Harley, like deliberately. Yeah. Like, you can't do that, you know.
Yeah, they were pushing it too hard.
Yeah.
But all right, guys, that's the show that we got for you tonight. So, dude, you want to let them know what we got coming up?
Yeah, guys. So later on tonight or tomorrow morning, first thing, we're gonna be posting the schedule up on the Comic Kingpin's Instagram page. Make sure you check that out. This week there was no Hall show, so no show on Thursday. Our next show is going to be this Saturday, 12 p.m. Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific for Royally Fucked. We're going to be going over previews, letting you guys know what we're pre-ordering, what we're not, what to keep your eye out for, that sort of thing. It's always a good time. You know, usually about an hour long. After that, we're going to be right back here on Monday, 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, for all the usual Monday night shenanigans, guys. We are going to be uploading some more shorts onto the channel, so keep an eye out for that. We'll try to make a post on our Instagram page. Whenever we do, just kind of let you guys know to, you know, go check it out. But, yeah, other than that, sorry?
Baker's got you back there, dude.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Other than that, though, once we get to 666, guys, we're going to do some giveaways. We've told you guys this a couple times now. Once we get there, it's going to be some fun. So we're going to keep pushing. We'll get there.
Fucking Dan. There you go.
Come on, Dan. Come on.
On that note, dude, you want to go ahead and get us out? Oh, actually, Sheik, what do you got coming up?
Not much. Just, you know, we got the shows next week with the Kingpins, and I've started uploading on my own channel again, just doing the retro comic ad stuff I do for fun and having some guests on. Hopefully, one of these days, getting the Kingpins on. We almost did last time, but scheduling just didn't work. But, yeah, it's pretty much it. So check it out, guys.
Hell yeah. All right, dude, guys. Have a good week. We'll see you guys on Saturday.
Hey, guys.
Oh, we did it again.